Hi, I'm Kelly Barham, and welcome to the April edition of LifePath. I'm so excited about this month's show because we have prepared some great stories that can help you alone in pursuing a healthy chiropractic lifestyle. I'm sure you'll enjoy them, so listen up. Pay close attention so you can learn more, but should any questions arise, don't be afraid to turn to your chiropractor. He or she is a great source of additional information that can help you in your healthy living. Meanwhile, as you're watching our show and learn something new, here's your friendly reminder to share your newfound knowledge with others. After all, it might change their lives, and how wonderful would that be? So do help others get on the path of healthy living. Share the benefits of proper nutrition that you've learned on our show, tips on exercise. But most importantly, don't forget to tell others about the benefits of chiropractic care. See, most people just don't know, and in that way, can't realize the benefits of chiropractic care. It's not about the back or neck pain, even though if you're experiencing it right now, I realize that's quite a valid complaint. In reality, however, chiropractic is so much more. It's about function. It's about well-being. It's about being the best you can be. So do share your experiences with others. Tell them what your chiropractor can do for them. Just that alone can change someone's life. So with that being said, why don't we turn to this month's show to learn a little more about the chiropractic lifestyle? Because in the end, the more you know, the better you're able to share. First, we'll be joining Dr. Lisa Olszewski. Listen to her inspirational story and her reason for becoming a chiropractor. But most importantly, why chiropractic care is for everyone, including children. Trust me, it's a story you don't want to miss. Then, we often speak of proper nutrition on our show. We have chefs that show you how to make scrumptious, healthy dishes. We talk about good food versus bad. So why don't we test you on what you've learned? Don't worry, it's really supposed to be fun, so just relax. I think you'll enjoy knowing how much you've learned and how much all of that knowledge can benefit your life. Now, talking about learning, however, if you still think that antibiotics are good for your children's ear infections, stop. They're only making it worse. So, as a parent, what are you supposed to do? Don't be intimidated into wrong type of thinking and wrong type of care. Educate yourself. That is why Dr. Dennis Kraft is here on our show today to help you do just that, to get you out of the frustrating endless rounds of medication and other invasive medical treatments that hurt more than help. Let him show you a better way. Your kids deserve it, and they need you to make the right choice for them. Speaking of right choices, exercise is always one of them. And this month, our exercise segment will include another yoga routine that you can do at home. It's so simple, it's hard to believe how beneficial it actually is for you. But with Rebecca Hagman, our certified yoga instructor, you don't have to work hard to reap age-defying benefits. So whether you are a man or woman, young or old, if you've never tried yoga before, Rebecca will get you started. Now, on this month's show, I'm also excited to introduce you to a new way of getting more stories to you. Via our satellite. Our remote truck is in Edwardsville, Illinois. We are scheduled to join Dr. Curtis Baird so we can explore a subject that affects so many. We'll be talking about fatigue. So if you are constantly drained or know people that are always complaining about how tired they are, this story is for you. But before we start our show, a quick reminder. As you listen to these stories that we prepared for you, remember those whom these stories can benefit as well. And if they are not yet under chiropractic care, refer them to your chiropractor. If they live out of the area, don't worry. I'm sure your chiropractor can find another excellent chiropractor that is more convenient for them. Everybody deserves to be taken care of just like you. So now, let's get to our show. Dr. Lisa Olszewski was into chiropractic way before she was born. Now, how is that possible? She'll tell you her story and what has made her such a strong believer in chiropractic care. In the end, it's all about communication, and not only about stories of what chiropractic care can achieve, but more importantly, about the communication that happens internally between your body and your brain. That is what Dr. Lisa gets to work with every day, and the significance of which fuels her passion for chiropractic care. So, are you ready to see why chiropractic is really such a big deal? Here's Dr. Lisa now.
Somehow, some way, somebody told you about chiropractic. We all have our amazing stories, and I want to share with you a little bit how I got into chiropractic and how I ultimately became a chiropractor. My story started many years before I was even born. My grandmother, or my babusia, which means grandmother in Polish, was pregnant with my dad 60-some years ago. She was told she wasn't going to make it out of the pregnancy alive. They actually told my grandfather, or my jaja, to take good care of her because only one person was going to make it out alive and it wasn't going to be her. She had a heart condition. So obviously, probably caused a lot of distress to her. And luckily, her father told her to go see a chiropractor. As she tells me today, she's like, I didn't really understand why I would go see a chiropractor for a heart issue, but her father urged her to go after he saw somebody basically crawling into a chiropractor's office in Toledo, Ohio, and then walked out. So again, back in the early 1950s, chiropractic was illegal still to practice within the state of Ohio. So she tells me how she had to walk up to the door and knock on the door and ask if the doctor was there, but he couldn't say that he was a doctor because he could go to jail for practicing medicine without a license. So she went and saw this chiropractor, and you already figured out the story. She made it out alive. She's going to be 90 this year, which is pretty amazing. So because of that, my father's been under chiropractic care since the day he was born. Or actually, I guess, before he was born. And so have I. I've been under chiropractic care since I've been born. So when I tell people that, you know, I've been under chiropractic care since I've been an infant, people often look at me quite strangely. Like, why would you see a chiropractor, or why would you ever take an infant or a baby to a chiropractor? Because they don't have headaches or back pain. True, but they do have a brain and a spinal cord. And that's what's so important in making sure that that communication is happening properly. Research shows 80% of us have the top two bones misaligned or subluxated during our birth process. And then all the falls and slips and accidents and injuries we take when we're learning to walk or riding a bike, or the silly things that I hear from the people in our practice about jumping off of rooftops as kids and falling out of trees and off horses, if they're not corrected, they're going to misalign the structure. And so what happens if your car is misaligned and you continue to drive it? You're going to get a flat tire, right? So we could look at that tire, take that tire off, put a new one on, and continue to drive the car. You're going to get another flat tire, right? Or we could change the oil and wash the windows and maybe vacuum it out. Those are great things to do for the car. But does it fix the alignment? It doesn't. There are a lot of great things you can do for your body, but really the only way to correct the alignment is through chiropractic. And so we want to make sure that your body's functioning at its best, that it's in the proper alignment. Your brain can send the right signals to the rest of your body. And so that's what we're looking for. So that's my chiropractic story. Obviously, I grew up underneath chiropractic care since I was little. I always wanted to be an engineer, and one day I decided I was going to become a chiropractor, and I never looked back. And it is the best thing ever in my life. I know that I'm fulfilling my purpose because I get to help people like you all day long see the great benefits about chiropractic care. Speaking of which, do you know what the very first chiropractic adjustment was for? September 18, 1895, Dr. D.D. Palmer worked on Harvey Lillard's spine. At some point in a conversation earlier, Lillard, who was a custodian or a janitor, had communicated to Palmer that he had lost his hearing when he stooped over to pick up a box and he felt something go out in his spine. So Palmer theorized if he lost his hearing that way, what would happen if he pushed back on that area and his hearing came back? So obviously, if I was Palmer, I probably would have thought I found a cure for deafness. But then the second adjustment was a man whose heart condition went away. So that's when Palmer theorized if two totally separate symptoms completely disappeared when working on the spine, it only made sense that your brain controls everything and that that spinal cord is just an extension of the brain. And if those bones go out of place, those messages aren't going to get sent to the proper areas of the body. So again, by chiropractic adjustments, that's what we do to make sure you're functioning as at the best. This was really communicated to me quite well. I was on a mission trip to Tobago a couple of months ago. And we were talking to everybody before we ever worked on them, just to explain to them the chiropractic story. And I just at one point walked up to somebody, and without like telling her that, I flat out asked her, I'm like, do you know what a chiropractor does? And she looked at me, she's like, yeah, I do. So I was kind of blown away because how is this lady, where there are pretty much no chiropractors on this island, how does she know what a chiropractor does? She looked at me and she's like, your brain controls everything. Bones go out of place, the messages can't get sent. Obviously, I looked at her like quite surprised, very happy that she understood the big idea. But she had been seeing the chiropractors on this mission trip years and years before. And then she looked at me, she's like, I come here every year whenever you guys are here. I need to make sure my messages are being sent to the rest of my body properly. So that's the true story about chiropractic. So who else can you help? Who else have you not told about your chiropractor? Because wouldn't the world be a better place if everybody had a properly functioning nervous system? Pain, A lot of times people think pain, whether or not they're healthy. Pain is only 10% of your nervous system. There's 90% of your nervous system that's going on that you can't feel. So I always tell the people in our practice, feeling good doesn't mean you're healthy. Just like sometimes if you're sick, might not mean that you're not healthy. Two different examples. What about somebody that's profusely throwing up? You think they're sick, right? In our typical society, that's what we think of. What if I told you they had food poisoning last night and their body is getting rid of those toxins? The body's adapting. It's doing exactly what it's supposed to be. Versus somebody that feels great, they think they're healthy, and we've heard this a lot. They dropped dead of a heart attack. Or they got diagnosed with cancer. Just because you're feeling good doesn't mean you're healthy. You want things to function properly. And so another thing I always tell everybody in our practice, could you live to be 105 with a little bit of back pain or a headache? Sure. Probably not going to be fun, but you could. Could you live to be 105 with a compromised nervous system? Probably not. So you want to make sure that nervous system is functioning as best as you can. So again, go back. Who else can you tell about chiropractic? I always go back to BJ Palmer, who is a developer of chiropractic, and he stated, you never know how far-reaching something you may think, say, or do today will affect the lives of millions tomorrow. So who can you tell that might affect the lives of millions tomorrow? It might even be you. So ask your chiropractor. They are such a resource of information. Even ask your chiropractor how they got into chiropractic. Maybe you don't know his or her story. But be sure to ask them. Share the story. Don't you think everybody deserves to be as healthy as possible? Think of how great you're doing now in comparison to however long ago it was that you started. So ask your chiropractor. Usually chiropractors are the best kept secret in healthcare in their community. Why don't you share the secret?
So how much do you really know about the things you were eating? I'm sure you're aware that some things are good for you and some not. Whether you have been watching our show or not, understanding such details, however, helps you make better choices for your health and your well-being. So why don't we test you a little right now? How about some multiple choice? Let's start with which food is considered by many to be an herbal wonder drug and a natural antibiotic? Carrots, cayenne pepper, garlic, or blueberries? If you guessed garlic, you're right. Modern science has actually proven that it is a natural antibiotic. It can also lower blood pressure and cholesterol levels. If you don't like the taste, which I don't know why, you can get garlic in supplement form. Tastes so good though. Now, which type of salmon is best to avoid buying or ordering in restaurants? Atlantic salmon, wild Alaska salmon, farm-raised salmon. Avoid all salmon. It's full of mercury. Well, this was actually a trick question. Yes, you do want to avoid farmed salmon, especially the kind grown in dense packed pens, fed fish meal polluted with toxic PCBs and given antibiotics to combat disease. Not all farm-raised salmon is bad, however. There is salmon out there that is raised using healthier farming methods. Sadly, however, you can't tell from the packaging which one is which. Now, Atlantic salmon, typically seen on restaurant menus, sounds wild. Unfortunately, it is also raised on farms, not in the ocean as the name would suggest. So it's wild only in its name and not your healthiest option. Truly, wild salmon, however, is highly nutritious, high in protein, high in good fats, you know, the omega-3s and low in contaminants. Wild is definitely the way to go. Now, moving on. Which fruit should you always buy organic? Strawberries, grapefruit, watermelon, or bananas? If you pick strawberries, you are right. Organic strawberries may cost more, but they actually taste better and are better for you. They contain higher levels of anti-cancer nutrients compared to the ones sprayed with pesticides. And pesticide residue isn't good for your health anyway. By the way, did you know that the recently approved strawberry pesticide, methyl iodide, has been called one of the most toxic chemicals on Earth. so spend a little extra and avoid the pesticide. Invest in your health by benefiting from the wonderful antioxidants found in organically grown strawberries. And again, they're delicious. Now, next question. What food is extremely low in calories, provides a whole host of nutrients, and can be tastefully combined with almost any other kind of food? Raw almonds, black beans, dark leafy vegetables, dark chocolate. While all the above have great health benefits in one form or another, your dark leafy vegetables are the answer. Vegetables like kale, spinach, Swiss chard, arugula, just to name a few, these dark leafy vegetables are a good source of many vitamins and minerals, as well as fiber, and we all need more of that. And listen up, modern research has even found that the nutrients found in these leafy vegetables can actually prevent certain types of cancers, not to mention promote heart health. Did you hear that? It sounds great. Whether raw, lightly steamed, or quickly sauteed, pile them on your plate today. Now, true or false? Brown eggs are healthier and more nutritious than white eggs. The answer is false. The difference is only in the color of the shell. What is important to look at when buying eggs, however, are the different labels that differentiate eggs and their quality. Labels such as cage-free, free-range, organic, hormone antibiotic-free. All of that will determine how nutritious your egg is, whether you pick brown or white. So read the labels carefully. And after all, it is the quality of the care of the chicken that will reflect the nutritional quality of an egg. And if you don't know, good eggs are full of healthy protein and fat and include vitamins A, D, B12, niacin, and folate. So choose right and eat up. Now, which of these is not a healthy sweetener? Honey, brown sugar, agave nectar, or stevia? The answer, brown sugar. Sorry, brown sugar, though it is less processed, is still sugar. And even though sweet, not very beneficial. Honey, on the other hand, and we're talking about raw organic, works not only as a natural energy booster, but also a great immune system builder and a natural remedy for many ailments out there. You can't beat that. Now, agave nectar is beneficial in that it has a very low glycemic value, which means that, unlike other sweeteners, it won't cause a sharp rise or fall in your blood sugar. It has also been found to have a variety of health benefits associated with it, including anti-inflammatory and immune system boosting properties, including antimicrobial capabilities. Did you know that? Well, I didn't. And if you've never heard of stevia, it is an herb native to South America that has become vastly popular here today. The leaf of the stevia plant contains compounds that give it sweetness, but does not raise your blood sugar. Sold in powder or liquid form, it is an excellent substitute for real sugar and not bad tasting either. Now, true or false, all fats are equal and equally bad for you. That is so false. Not all fats are created equal. Saturated and trans fats are bad. They raise your cholesterol level and increase your risk of heart disease. Now, monounsaturated fats and polyunsaturated fats, on the other hand, are good. They've been known to lower cholesterol and reduce your risk of heart disease. And remember, a fat-free label doesn't mean you can eat all you want without affecting your waistline. Many fat-free foods are high in sugar, refined carbohydrates, and calories that only add the pounds. So, where can you find the good fats that can actually help you stay trim? Virgin olive oil, avocado, fatty fishes such as salmon, almonds, just to name a few. And bad? Well, they lurk in ice cream, cheese, French fries, margarine, processed and other man-made foods. Get the idea? These are the kind of fats to avoid. Now, let's move on to our next question. Which of the following common ingredients you read on package labels really means sugar? Sucrose, fructose, corn syrup, dextrose. Trick question. They all are. All of the above act like sugar in your body, raising your blood sugar and insulin levels and widening your waistline. So watch out and read the labels. Now, true or false, GMO foods, GMO standing for genetically modified organisms, are clearly marked on food labels. Sadly, that's false. And GMO ingredients are now present in 75 to 80% of conventional processed food sold in the U.S. And to make it worse, labeling of GMOs is not mandatory in the U.S., whereas 30 other countries around the world, including Australia, Japan, and all of the nations of the European Union, have either banned or significantly restricted their use. Now, I think that alone speaks on the safety of consuming GMO foods, so do your research. Study up on why you should restrict GMOs in your diet. So tell me, how did you do? Diet nutrition often seems so complicated. Should you do this? Should you do that? It gets confusing. You, however, have a wonderful tool in your hands, the internet. The information is out there. Do your research. Your reward will be better health for you and your family, and that's what we, along with your chiropractor, are all about. So, are you ready to learn more? I hope so. We'll be right back. Ear infections. If you're a parent that's new to chiropractic care, most likely you've had to deal with it and deal with it more than once. How do I know that? Because even modern medical literature shows that antibiotics don't work for children's ear infections and only contribute to more recurring ones and more often. Did you know that? So why is it the antibiotic treatment is so widely accepted? Well, the truth is, and as hard as it may be to accept, but don't take my word for it, because again, it's noted in modern medical literature, most pediatricians just don't know what to do and even surrender giving their own children dangerous drugs that don't work. Isn't that sad? So what are you supposed to do as a parent? It's a horrible place to be watching your child cringe in pain. I've been there and I know. Well, that is why we have Dr. Dennis Kraft here on our show. From diet to chiropractic care and their effects on the immune system, you'll learn what you can do so your child won't have to suffer ever again.
I want to talk to you today about one of the most common ailments that parents seek care for their children for in the first 5 years of lives. That's childhood ear infections. If you're a parent, you probably experienced this yourself. What causes so many of these ear infections to occur? Well, there's a variety of things, but many of them are due to childhood traumas, maybe as early as the birth process, coming down through the birth canal, perhaps using forceps, perhaps just the rotation of the head of the child while it's being pulled, or maybe even suction deliveries. These types of things can create misalignments in the upper portion of the neck of a child. This upper portion of the neck does have a direct control to the mucus flow of the ears, the throat, and the sinuses. Excess mucus production within these portions of the anatomy will prevent the ears from draining properly. As a result of that, the ears tend to get inflamed and irritated and become infected. I want you to know that it's rarely a bacterial infection. Probably less than 10% of the ear infections a child experiences are bacterial infection. But the most common form of treatment for ear infections is repetitive antibiotic use. In my practice, I have seen this over and over again, and I've had the privilege of working with many parents who have children with recurrent childhood ear infections and are able to get them off from the antibiotics because they're not working anyway. They don't work against viral infections, and get them functioning, get their nervous system functioning to the point where it's not a recurrent episode for them. So what I want you to do is think about how the immune system works. If we develop an infection of any type, the body has an immune response to that, as long as it's unimpeded in its process. If we develop mucus as a result of an infection, it's the body's way of walling off or controlling an irritant where it's at so the body's immune response can treat it at that site. Mucus is not necessarily a bad thing as long as it's part of the immune response. If there's an excess production of mucus due to food allergies or environmental toxins, perfumes, dyes, preservatives, things of that nature, we need to get that under control. But to try to dry up the mucus within the system of within the area of an infection is oftentimes allowing that infection to grow and proliferate in that region. So we need mucus so that the body can expectorate that that toxin out of the system. How about a cough? A cough is the body's way of getting rid of this mucus and with it the invading irritants. So to suppress a cough is in effect helping to defeat the body's immune response. How about a fever? A fever can be miserable for a child and it can be miserable for the parents as well. No parent wants to sit and watch their child suffer. So as a result of that, as soon as a child gets a fever, we try to give it Tylenol or ibuprofen or something of that nature. Do you know that a fever is the body's immune system in function, in action? And when we suppress a fever, we are in essence shutting down that immune system. Studies have shown, and it's documented in the medical literature, that for every degree a fever raises, the amount of immunity cells that our body produces is doubled. So fever is a good thing. We can't work on trying to break a fever if the body is trying to fight something. Too high of a fever? Yes. But if we're talking about a child under the age of 2 years old, 3 years old, and even on up, as long as it stays under 104 degrees, let that body have a chance to work. I am a parent. I understand how miserable it can be to watch your child be in discomfort. I've had my child come down with RSV. And as a chiropractor, I know the power of the innate being within us and its ability to help these things heal. And I watch my child develop these fevers. I watch my child develop the respiratory distress and become miserable for 2 days. It was the hardest thing that I ever had to do to watch him be miserable and not try to intervene and make him more comfortable. But I did it. I did it and I adjusted him. Our nervous system is what controls that immune system. Our nervous system is what allows that mucus flow to regulate it. So what allows the body to express its innate intelligence. Our immune system is like a muscle. Have you ever wondered why the people who get sick the least are the people who get exposed the most? Why do doctors rarely get sick? Why do nurses rarely get sick? Why do dentists or teachers? It's because they're exposed all of the time. And when we are exposed to something, our body tends to develop a resistance against it, as long as we allow it to do so. If we go out and we take a drug for every ache and pain and creak and strain and sniffle and sneeze and everything that we're exposed to, we're consistently defeating the body's immune response. We need to allow the body to function. We need to release the interference within the system and allow the body to function. Get rid of the toxicities. Avoid the sugars and the fats and the dairies and the wheats and the chemicals that we're all exposed to on a regular basis, and especially our children. Instead, feed them pureed fruits and vegetables and whole food supplementation, omega-3 fatty acids, maybe probiotics to rebuild the intestinal flora, especially if they've been on antibiotics. Our gut, our intestinal system is 80% of our immune system, and when we take those antibiotics, they kill all of that good bacteria as well as the bad bacteria that may be in our system, so we need to replenish this. I've had children, as I said, that have been on antibiotics for 7 straight years, prophylactically every day, because every time the parent would take them off from the drug, they would get another ear infection. And as a result of that, she finally decided to bring them into my office. And within 2 months of chiropractic care, relieving the interference on the nervous system, reworking the immune response, rebuilding the nutritional system within the body, the child never had another infection. I can go on with story after story about how childhood ear infections are improved with chiropractic care, as long as the parents understand the concept and try to take away the irritants as well. Mothers, if you're nursing, don't put your baby on its side, on the same side all of the time. Some of the bacteria or the viruses in the mouth can run into the ear. Don't ever lay your body or your baby on its back with a bottle in its mouth. Their eustachian tubes are oriented so that they have a direct connection to the ear, and it allows that that contaminant to drain down into the ears. It's simple things that you can do. So I know you're all chiropractic patients if you're watching this. I know that you have children, and I know if you don't have children that you know people who do, and most children come down with these ear infections. So seek instructions from your chiropractor, seek care from your chiropractor. Let's help these children grow up to be healthy in every aspect of their lives. Thank you.
Have you ever considered yoga? After all, it's one of the best forms of exercise for strength, tone, and flexibility. All of those things that contribute to an anti-aging lifestyle, and all of those things that can be touched upon in a single routine. Don't believe me? Really, it can be that simple. If you're absolutely new to yoga, let our instructor, Rebecca Hagman, walk you through some of the steps to show you how. Yes, you literally can reap major health benefits with minimal effort. It is not too good to be true if you just do it. So follow along as I clear the floor for Rebecca now.
Yoga is not complicated and anybody can do it. Today I want to show you how simple it can be. We're going to do some exercises that improve the back health and the hips by increasing flexibility with the back and the hips. The first pose that we do, we're going to start on all fours, and it's a flow actually called cow, cat, plank, and down dog. We're going to have our arms coming directly out of our shoulder sockets, and we're going to have our thighs coming directly out of our hip sockets. And so on the inhale, we are going to lift our head up and leading with the chin, and that will cause our hips to go up towards the ceiling as well. And on the exhale, we're going to tuck our hips in and tuck our head in for cat, arching our back, and that's all on an exhale. Then for plank, we're going to inhale, come onto the tops of our toes and lift our knees up for a straight back and straight legs. And on an exhale, we're going to lift up our hips up high, bringing our chest towards our quads for down dog. So this all goes into a flow pattern. And on the inhale, we come back to all fours. So let's give that a try, starting with the inhale. And in cow, lifting the head and allowing the pelvis to tilt up. Exhale, tucking the pelvis and the head in for cat. Inhale into plank, coming into straight legs and straight back and head out. Exhale, lifting the hips up high and bringing the chest towards the quads for down dog. And let's do that two more times together. Inhaling into cow. Exhale into cat. Inhale into plank. Keep that butt down and exhale. Now lift the butt up for downward facing dog, bringing the chest towards the quads. And last one, inhale into cow. Exhale cat. Inhale plank. Straight back, exhale, and downward facing dog. Inhale, come back to all fours, and let's go ahead and sit down for head to knee pose. So this one is a hip flexor. It helps to open up the hips. You're going to draw the right leg in and have the foot at the groin. And on an inhale, you straighten out your back and bring the belly button towards the straight leg, dorsiflex the toe, and exhale and lead with the chest down. If we bring our head down, we lose the integrity of the pose, and the purpose of the pose is to strengthen the core at the same time that you're stretching out the core and opening up the hips. And we'll hold each of these poses for 5 breaths when you're doing it on your own. On the inhale, you would come up out of the pose and you're going to switch sides. So again, for when you're practicing on your own, you're going to hold these for 5 breaths. And exhale, going into the pose, leading with the chest. Today I'm just giving you a sampler, and you can join me And then on your own, you go longer. And inhale and coming out of the pose. Okay? Both legs out for a nice forward bend. And again, we're just bending at the hips. Dorsiflex the toes and exhale, leading with the chest down. And we want the head out, looking towards the toes in order to keep the neck in alignment with the back. And after holding the pose for 5 breaths, coming out of that one as well. Draw the legs in for what's called easy pose. Then you're going to have one foot or one leg in front of the other. They're not going to be crossed, but they're going to be in front of each other. And you're going to have the right hand, we'll start putting it down at the hip, getting that shoulder blade back and the back nice and straight. And the left hand comes up and it reaches over the head and looks straight. And feel that stretch in the left-hand side as you're opening up the space between the vertebrae with this stretch. On the inhale, come back to neutral and switch. So left hand goes down, pushes into the mat, gets the shoulder blade back and the back nice and straight. And then on the exhale, reach over into crescent pose and stretching out the right side of the body. The rib cage, the back, opening up, creating space. And on the inhale, come out of that and release. We're gonna go forward for the next one. On the exhale, just folding forward at the hips, leading with the chest, bringing the chest down to the mat and over the hips. If your hips are really stiff, this is an excellent pose for that. And just go down as far as you can. And after 5 breaths, you're going to switch because we work our body asymmetrically because our body is asymmetrical. And we're going to do the same thing here. So if this is your pose and you can't get down any further, that's okay. If your knees are up because they're tight, that's okay too. Just work on tilting the pelvis forward, keeping the chest, leading with the chest and the back nice and straight as you start to open up those hips, okay? After that, we're gonna come down onto our chest and onto our mat, having our hands right at the chest. We're pushing the tops of our feet and the legs into the mat. We do not wanna have loose legs because we want to be able to protect our lower back by having engaged leg muscles. And on the inhale, we lift our torso up, keeping the pelvis on the mat, and we can hold this for 5 breaths, trying to breathe from the belly and lower down after that you have done 5. Even if you do 3, that's great. Go ahead and open up the legs and come onto your haunches. This is called child's pose. It's a nice restorative pose. It will help to release any tension that was created in the lower back or the sacrum while doing cobra pose. And after 5 breaths here, we're going to come back into down dog as our inversion. So tucking your toes, lifting your hips up nice and high, bring your pelvis to the quads. Inversions are wonderful. This helps again to open up the spine and it gets your head lower than your heart, which helps to increase neuronal activity. And the studies that they are doing now in yoga therapy are linking the improvement of your chances of not getting Alzheimer's. So preventing Alzheimer's when you do inversions. So I certainly want to do these every day as much as I can. And after you're done with down dog, come back on to your knees and into child's pose to finish up the routine in child's pose, which is a nice restorative again and releasing any tension that was built up during that sequence. And that is it. I hope that you enjoy that. And again, the more flexible that you become, the more healthy that you will be. Thank you.
fatigue. At one time or another, it affects us all. Sometimes we just need a little kick to make it through the day. For others, however, fatigue can be so serious that it can affect the quality of their lives. So, can chiropractic help? If you're dragging yourself around, constantly fighting your own exhaustion, are there changes that you can make in your lifestyle that could make a difference? Well, Dr. Curtis Baird will be joining me remotely via satellite to answer these questions. I'm told he's ready to go, so let's join him now. Dr. Curtis, hey, it's great you could take the time to join us.
Kelly, I'm glad to join you.
Great. We're here to talk about fatigue, but make me understand, how does this relate to chiropractic?
Fatigue is one of the most common complaints we see in a patient when they come in. The nervous system is ultimately the one organ system that is responsible for coordinating all the other systems of the body, especially those systems that require in making energy for us to help us do the things and adapt to the stressors in our daily lives.
I get an adjustment. I'm going to feel full of energy, or are there other factors involved?
Well, an improvement in energy isn't anything unusual for someone experiencing an adjustment. But for many, many other different reasons and choices that we make in our life and our lifestyles, such as not enough sleep or eating improperly, can also contribute to the issue of fatigue. So it's not, the nervous system itself may not have the proper tools to be able to use the energy that it needs to make us feel energetic.
Well, a lot of times we talk here about lifestyle, eating well, but sometimes around that 3 o'clock hour, I start running out of energy. Is there anything wrong with going out and grabbing one of those energy drinks, or sometimes in the local store, I see the 5 hour energy tablets or bottle. Is that gonna perk me up with some energy? Maybe a little bit, something?
Oh, it'll surely perk you up, but it'd be the same thing as whipping a dead horse. You're not going to get, the permanent energy or the sustainable energy that you would like to get from those types of products. Remember, it takes a lot more than just caffeine or carbohydrates to make energy. There are a lot of other subtle little micronutrients involved way down at the very molecular levels of the body's chemistry to also help produce energy, which the nervous system, again, is responsible for coordinating.
Okay, well, getting back to lifestyle and eating right, are there foods that will perk me up, perk up my energy? Or, I know you should be eating well, but are there certain foods that will increase my energy levels? Something, I mean, I'm sure there is.
Foods most likely to increase your energy and give you a long sustained, of course, is a balanced diet, which means that you need to eat a certain amount of proteins in relationship to carbohydrates, as well as good healthy fats. All of those different macronutrients burn at different rates, and that's what gives us a sustained level of energy throughout the day. If you're eating too many carbohydrates, you're going to get a fast burn, but you're eventually going to crash, probably within an hour and a half, 2 hours after eating them. If you eat a high fat meal, you're probably going to feel a little bulky right after eating and be feeling a little extra fatigued just because it takes more energy to actually break the fats down and convert them to even more energy. But after about 4 hours, you're going to lose that energy burst that you'll get from fats, good healthy fats. And then last, proteins are the slowest to be converted to an energy source, and you're going to get a nice long burn, but again, proteins take a lot of energy to convert to energy itself. So not only are you using energy just to make the conversion process, but you're going to wait a long time for that energy to come about. So if you eat all three in a balanced form, you'll get a nice sustained level of energy from every meal that you eat.
Well, okay. I mean, I eat fairly well, but with our busy schedule come 2 or 3 o'clock, I go through this energy slump. Is there a fruit, or what would be a good energy source? Anything to help me, just perk me up a little bit, something.
Nature makes all kinds of wonderful little foods that would work well for that. Though the one I like to point to most people, they're already individually packed, they're called grapes. Little bite-sized, individually packed foods, just loaded with sugar. They also contain many good essential nutrients in them, as well as as well as some of the other things. All foods that nature makes contains proteins, fats, and carbohydrates. So you're going to get a good balanced thing from grapes. Other fruits would work out well. But the last thing you want to do is eat something like the Snickers bar, or going out to Starbucks and getting yourself a latte or whatever else it is they make.
So no quick candy bars, really?
No quick candy bars. That will definitely burn energy more than you want to have burned.
Besides nutrition and the adjustments, what else should someone look at?
Are they getting enough sleep? We live in one of the most stressful societies that the world's ever seen. And sleep is one of the first things thrown out in our lifestyle. So if you're not getting enough sleep, and remember, our bodies need 8 hours of sleep each and every day to repair and restore energy levels from the day's previous stress, if we're not getting enough sleep to restore that process, we're going to eventually experience this wonderful thing called chronic tiredness or fatigue.
Well, now I'm getting my sleep, I'm eating right, but I'm still feeling sluggish. Is there other stressors on your body that what else could be dragging me down?
Exercise is essential to this entire process. And most people think, well, exercise, you're actually using energy. And yes, you are using energy. Mm-hmm. But the sheer process of training your body to use that energy, you're also training it to utilize and manufacture and make more energy through the day as well. And it's going to help you in the long run. Even though you may not want to feel like exercising because you are fatigued. The second thing is that exercise also burns off a lot of those stress hormones that we were talking about. And those stress hormones actually are metabolized by the process of energy, especially of the big muscles of the body.
Okay, well, you talk about stress hormones. Can stress fatigue me out?
Stress most certainly can. That's why it's called stress. Stress is something that requires the body to use more energy, but it uses it again under duress, I guess is the best way to say it. And because it's using it under duress, we're actually forcing the body again to steal from Peter to pay Paul.
You know, I'm sure people are sitting out there thinking, where do I go from here? Where do I start?
Ultimately, it starts with talking to your chiropractor about this. Your chiropractor will be able to help you out with most any symptom that you bring to them. They will be able to use tools as simple questionnaires to maybe help figure this out for you, all the way up into doing some simple diagnostics as well. It's important to also have them maybe help you in making some lifestyle decisions and lifestyle choices that might help balance your life out a little bit better from a day-to-day basis. It's important as well for us to literally sit back and realize that according to several different studies, we are actually more stressed out by a factor of almost 10, more so than what we were a century ago.
Wow, well, this is a wealth of information. I want to thank you for joining us.
Thank you for having me.
It's been great. We've come to the end of this month's show. I hope you've enjoyed it, gained some insight, maybe even a new direction living a chiropractic lifestyle. And for that, I want to thank all of our guests for taking the time from their busy schedules to share their expertise and advice with you. And just as our guests took the time to share their knowledge and their passion with you, don't let it end here. Share the information you've learned on this month's show with people that you meet in your life. Remember earlier in the show when Dr. Lisa recited a quote from B.J. Palmer, the developer of chiropractic? You never know how far-reaching something that you may think, say, or do today will affect the lives of millions tomorrow. That notion is so important, I wanted to share it with you again. By spreading the word, you may help someone else find the benefits of chiropractic for themselves and their loved ones, and with that, change their lives for the better. In turn, they too may spread the word of chiropractic. And together, yes, we have a chance of making a difference in our nation and maybe even the world. Chiropractic can benefit everybody now, and it can benefit our future generations, but only if people know about it. So it has to start with you. Talk with your family and your friends about the benefits of chiropractic care. Show them what it's like to live a chiropractic lifestyle. You really can make a difference, and education can be the key. So, if you had any questions on what you've seen on this month's episode of Life Path, don't hesitate to talk to your chiropractor. He or she is a great source of information that can help you and your loved ones in making healthier choices in life. After all, you can have the knowledge to change your life and lives around you. But knowledge is only part of the equation. Knowledge without action is wasted. So, as we come to the end of this month's show, go out, make the difference you want to see in this world. Tell people about chiropractic.